our perception.
Our money
should be dismissed. The game was made of something different. He said, the interior of air is arising from perception, but I am not happy to be that. One of the limits of human perception may or may not be aware of. As I have said before, man's chief illusion is the conviction that he can do. All people think that they can do.
without becoming subject to another. The whole thing, all work on oneself, consists in choosing the influence to which you wish to subject yourself, and actually falling under this influence. And for this it is necessary to know beforehand which influence is the more profitable. What interested me in this talk is that G spoke of the planets and the moon as living beings, having definite ages, a definite period of life and possibilities of development and transition to other planes of being. From what he said, it appears that the moon is not a dead planet, as is usually accepted, but, on the contrary, a planet in birth, a planet at the very initial stages of its development which had not yet reached the degree of intelligence possessed by the Earth, as he expressed it. The moon is growing and developing. combination of these divisions and gradations seem to me empty and useless, simply arguments about words. In what G had said, in his indications of the different levels which we fail to see and understand, I felt an approach to the very gradations that I had felt but could not define. In general, many things which G said astonished me. There were ideas which I could not accept and which appeared to me fantastic and without foundation. Other things, on the contrary, coincided strangely with what I had thought myself and with what I had arrived at long ago. I was most of all interested in the connectedness of everything he said. I already felt that his ideas were not detached one from another, as all philosophical and scientific ideas are, but made one whole, of which, as yet, I saw only some of the pieces. I thought about that in the night train, on the way from Moscow to Petersburg. I asked myself whether I had indeed found what I was looking for. Was it possible that G actually knew what had to be known in order to proceed from words or ideas to deeds, to facts? I was still not certain of anything, nor could I formulate anything precisely. But I had an inner conviction that something had already changed for me and that now everything would go differently. Chapter 2. In Petersburg, the summer passed with the usual literary work. I was preparing my books for new editions, reading proofs, and so on. This was the terrible summer of 1915 with its gradually lowering atmosphere, from which, in spite of all efforts, I could not free myself. The war was now being waged on Russian territory and was coming nearer to us. Everything was beginning to totter. The hidden suicidal activity which has determined so much in Russian life was becoming more and more apparent. A trial of strength was in progress. Printers were perpetually going on strike. My work was held up. And I was already beginning to think that the catastrophe would be upon us before I succeeded in doing what I intended. But my thoughts very often returned to the Moscow talks. Several times when things became particularly difficult, I remember I said to myself, I will give up everything and go to G in Moscow. And at this thought I always felt easier. Time passed. One day, it was already autumn, I was called to the telephone and heard G's voice. He had come to Petersburg for a few days. I went to see him at once and, in between conversations with other people who came to see him on various matters, he spoke to me just as he had in Moscow. When he was leaving next day, he told me he would soon be coming back again. And on this second visit, when I told him about a certain group I went to in Petersburg, where all possible subjects were discussed, from war to psychology, he said that acquaintance with similar groups might be useful, as he was thinking of starting the same kind of work in Petersburg as he was conducting in Moscow. He went to Moscow and promised to return in a fortnight. I spoke with him to some of my friends and we began to await his arrival. He returned again for a short time. I succeeded, however, in introducing some people to him. In regard to his plans and intentions, he said he wanted to organize his work on a larger scale, give public lectures, arrange a series of experiments and demonstrations, and attract to his work people with a wider and more varied preparation. All this reminded me of a part of what I had heard in Moscow. But I did not clearly understand. What experiments and demonstrations he spoke of, this became clear only later. I remember one talk, as usual with G, in a small cafe on the Nevsky. G told me in some detail about the organization of groups for his work and about their role in that work. Once or twice he used the word esoteric, which I had not heard from him before, and I was interested in what he meant by it. But when I tried to stop and ask what he meant by the word esoteric, he avoided an answer. This is not important. Well, each call it what he liked, he said. That is not the point. The point is that a miraculous is the beginning of everything. One man can do nothing, can attain nothing.
Greater and greater.
joy, etc., never succeeded in coming to our meetings. A great deal I afterwards understood differently from the way I did then. And his chief motive became clear to me. He by no means wanted to make it easy for people to become acquainted with his ideas. On the contrary, he considered that only by overcoming difficulties, however irrelevant and accidental, could people value his ideas. People do not value what is easily come by, he said. And if a man has already felt something, believe me, he will sit waiting all day at the telephone in case he should be invited. Or he will himself ring up and ask and inquire. And whoever expects to be asked.